products that GC, GC, is that?
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, for the kind introduction. As a true experimentalist, I tend to look at the other side of the catalyst to try to understand what is happening on the catalyst. So I'll tell you a little bit more on what we are doing with the analysis of the comparative analysis of official drops product. The overview for the talk, I want to give a quick introduction. I know that there's a lot of other people really back to the introduction of official drops and so on, so I want to skip that. I want to show you the GC times GC setup that we have. Comparison of analysis. I want to show you some of the new data that we are able to generate now, and then I think a very nice example of the power of GC times GC. Then some conclusions and future research. Now, we all know that fission drops is the chain growth of syngas. We can do it with a few different catalysts, low temperature catalyst or high temperature catalyst. We know that we can do it with iron ore with cobalt. As I said, fission drops is a polymerization reaction, but there's two very different, very interesting reactions that has occurred. One is the chain growth, and the other one is the desorption of the catalyst. If you look at a normal 1D gas chromatograph spectrum, you will see that you can typically ID the olefins and the paraffins and then the alcohols, but there's a little bit of noise at the bottom. Now, if we blow that noise up and we are interested in the oxygenates, it's virtually impossible to identify the oxygenates out of that. If you look carefully, you will see that that peak, if I just remove it, that peak is a acid peak sitting underneath the noise. And we know that we are making a substantial amount of oxygenates in fission drops from aldehydes, ketones. We know that that is a valuable product that we can sell them. In a fuel plant, however, oxygenates are not that a good thing. So we need to know what to do to make oxygenates or not to make it. And I think a lot of our friends in the hydrotreating business will know that oxygenates in hydrotreating is not good. Furthermore, acids will compromise certain materials of construction. It can also impact on the mechanical integrity of the catalyst and cause catalyst degradation. Now, the whole aim of this research is to develop a selectivity model so that we can either limit the catalyst degradation, understand the correlation between process conditions and oxygenates, and if possible, make more oxygenates for possible chemical plant. But as I said, for a true fuels plant, we don't want any oxygenates, but we will make from in alcohols to branched acids. We need to understand where they come from. Now, GC times GC as a tool is very powerful. You can analyze or separate a wide range of product from paraffins, looking at the branching, the aromatics, the acid, the branched acid. It's possible to look at the whole range. And now for the first time we can identify Fischer-Tropsch products that were not really known in the past. And we can now quantify it, we can now separate it by carbon number. The typical reactor setup that we use to generate this is a CSTR reactor where we feed syngas and syngas in and then collect the hydrocarbon products at the end. This pot is at high temperature and we will typically drain wax out of it. The second pot is cold and there we will get the water and oil fraction, and then to the overhead we will get the gas fraction, which is also very important. As I said, we want to quantify the Fischer-Tropsch product, and if we can do it from C1 to C15, then that would already help us to understand the mechanism of how we make this product. You can clearly see that it's a very diverse product with a very, very wide boiling range, from heavy wax to very light gas, as I said, from paraffins to acids. And if we want to build this whole picture, we need to analyze the wax and the oil and the water and the gas, put everything together. Now, this is a typical product spectrum, and I quickly want to show how we manage to get to a tunable product. There you'll see that the light fraction is typically coming from the cold air analysis that's going overhead. The oil fraction will give you from about C4 to C30, C35. There's a water fraction, and typically that's oxygenates, and then the wax fraction. If we look at the setup of the GC type GC, maybe I must quickly give you some background. Typically, we use two columns with different polarity to separate the hydrocarbons. The first one is a long 50-meter polar column, and then in the second dimension, we use a non-polar column, which is run isothermal for the short analysis, but we ramp the whole oven up in temperature from the low temperature to high temperature. We use two different ovens to manage to get the products in the second dimension out faster. Now this is a typical oil analysis. Let me quickly explain to you. This is the long column, and that will be the shorter column. So you'll see that the short column, everything must come out after about 7 seconds. Otherwise, we will get overlap of the analysis. And typically, this is the type of information we are able to generate. You can see we can now start to separate the RF, the linear paraffins from the branched paraffins, the alpha olefins from the internal olefins from the branched olefins. We can also look in detail on the oxygenates, especially the alcohols, the acids. And if you can carefully look, that would typically be the linear alcohol with the alcohol at the end, and those would be either branched alcohols or internal alcohols. So now we have a tool to really understand the Fischer-Tropsch product spectrum. If we focus in a little bit, you'll see that there are a lot of very small peaks, and we use GC times GC MS power flight, GC times GC, to identify these type of products. And we also spiked some of the compounds to make sure of our identification. There's, however, a few issues with GC times GC, especially if you look at the Fischer-Tropsch product. In a low temperature iron oil fraction alone, we were able to identify about 1,500 peaks. That's only from C5 to C25. The presentation of these numbers are really problematic. It's a very complex stream. If you look at the whole FT product, it's not really easy to analyze that in a one analysis. So we've built a GC type GC setup with five columns only to analyze the gas fraction. We've used two valves on the one side of the GC, a modulator to separate the oxygenates out of the from the other hydrocarbons and to get a GC times GC analysis, and we've used a standard FID with a one-dimension analysis to separate the C1, C2, C3 from the rest. Now this is a gas analysis, and you'll clearly see that the C1, C2, C3, we cannot modulate, so we get the whole bunch out as just one line. But we are able to separate the C4, C5s, and the alcohols, and the, I believe the acids are sitting around here. And that's just a full analysis of a gas, and you can clearly see that the acids are. If we add everything up, add the cold tail and the hot tail, GC times GC together, clearly you can see that we can correlate our 1D analysis with the 2D analysis. The normal 1D analysis, it's the black, and the hot tail where we use the GC times GC is the red lines, and this gives us a very good correlation between what we see on the one side versus. We look at the oil exactly the same, one-dimensional GC, the black lines, the two-dimensional GC is the red one. If we look at the, we just remove all the major compounds, we see that there's a lot of, there's the, I think that's the branched olefins, and there's a lot of other information as well. Look at the oxygenates, we can now clearly look at the alcohols, the inner alcohols, the secondary alcohols, the branched alcohols. But I think the whole purpose of this type of analysis is to understand Fischer-Tropsch and to understand the mechanism. What we did here was to plot acid fraction, or the linear acid fraction, and we need to correlate this now with the alpha values we are getting for the rest of the Fischer-Tropsch products. I've included here only the oxygenates, but you can clearly see that we can determine the alpha for the inner alcohols. If that's the linear acids, they are the branched alcohols, the internal alcohols. I haven't included the branched acids, but they sit here at very low concentrations. Now to give you an example of how we use this type of thing, how we can use this type of information to try to understand a mechanism of formation of Fischer-Tropsch product on a catalyst surface. If we look at the branching of Fischer-Tropsch products and compare the branching in only in the acid fraction versus that of the alcohol fraction of paraffins and olefins, I've used just a few sets of data, and I want to quickly explain to you. You can see that the conditions we used to generate this data is ranging from 210 to 270 degrees. The conversion was from low conversion to high conversion. We look at only the C10 fraction, the selectivity varied, the paraffin selectivity varied from 27% to 19%, olefins from 67% to 35%, and the alcohols from very high selectivity to very low selectivity. And this is typically the information that we can generate. If you look at the percentage branching, and this is now the, if we take this as an example, this is saying that about 23% of the C6, I believe that's the C6, the C6 acids, 23% of the acids on the C6 fraction is branched. About 19% of the alcohols is branched. On the paraffins, it's about 10%. And on the alcohols, it's about, on the olefins, it's about 6-7%. Now, if we only look at the C10 fraction, and I've plotted here the percentage branching versus the temperature, you'll see that over the wide range of temperature, there's not really a correlation. If we plot it at syngas conversion, there's also no correlation. We plot it at the hydrogen to CO ratio, and I must just show you that we've only tested from 1.4 to 2.2, so it's not that wide a range. We can also not see any correlation. Now, what conclusion can we make out of this? I think we can clearly say that the branching in the acids, or let me quickly go back. The branching in the acids are clearly higher than that of the olefins or of the alcohols, and that is clearly higher than that of the paraffins and on the olefins. And we can also say it's not dependent on temperature. It's not really dependent on hydrogen to CO ratio, that the range that we've looked at, and it's also not dependent on the conversion or for that matter the water concentration. Now, can we explain this? Why do we get branching from the Fischer-Tropsch product? I think we can clearly say that branching is not a secondary reaction. If it was a secondary reaction, then what would happen? If there was an in alcohol, and that alcohol would reabsorb at the surface, we would form a carbocation, and that would mean that the OH would have to leave the catalyst. Further, then we would get isomerization, and then the product would leave as a branched olefin. But that's not what we saw. We saw that the branching in the alcohols are a lot higher than the branching of the olefins. So that's clearly not a secondary reaction. It must therefore be a primary reaction. Now, can we try to explain this? I know Professor Iglesias said that there's too many mechanisms, but I'm sorry, there's another one. If we say that there's two pathways to make a Fischer-Tropsch product, you will, well, there's another one as well, and which is the chain growth one, but that one I want to leave out. If we have a product coordinated to a surface in the how to present this. But that type of product can desorb to form an aldehyde, and before that they should be able to desorb as an acid. That product can also be hydrogenated to an alcohol and then leave as an alcohol, or further hydrogenated and leave as an olefin, or further hydrogenated and then leave as a paraffin. If we now look at the branching, and here I must say that typically we see about 80% of the branching on the two position. There are also branches there, but about 80% of it sits at the two position. We can exactly say the same here, but remember that if there's a branch there, I would say that this product would desorb a lot easier than the linear one. Or if that branching is covering a little bit more of the surface, then hydrogenation would be slower, which would explain that for the alcohols and for the acids, we saw a higher branching than that of the olefins and the paraffins. So, what we can say is that hydrogenation of the linear products is faster than the hydrogenation of the branch product, or we can say that the desorption of the branch product are easier than that of the linear product because of the alcohol that's sitting there. Our conclusions, what we can make is that branching occurs while the product is coordinated on the catalyst surface. It's not a secondary reaction, it's not a skeletal isomerization. It is clearly a kinetic effect. It has something to do with the desorption or the hydrogenation. And I believe that we need a lot more answers and better analysis of the acids and the aldehydes to try to understand this phenomenon. Now, overall conclusion. I think that one-dimensional GC is acceptable for routine analysis for paraffins and alpha olefins and cis and trans internals and so on. But if you really want to look at the low-level compounds, you need to look at a better analysis. And I think the GC times GC analysis is not bad. And I also showed to you that we are now able in the position that we can analyze the C1 to C3 fraction, and we can get alpha plots of aldehydes, ketones, and acids, and so on. Some future research, all of this needs to go back into model development if we want to tailor make the efficient transfer product, either to make fuels or alcohols or so on. We need to understand this a lot. And some acknowledgement, just two people who really worked hard generating a lot of the data. And then we've got colleagues at Scientific Supply who've maintained and set up the GC times GC for us.
Really happening on the iron catalyst. And this was an iron catalyst?
This, sorry, I have to say this is an iron catalyst. The cobalt catalyst, the oxygenate levels are just a lot lower, and we don't have the techniques now to analyze the iron.